Hello and welcome to OT Over Easy. My name is Becca and today we are talking about ergonomics and injury prevention in the workplace. This is the third video in a series about work rehabilitation, so if you haven't seen the other two, be sure to check those out. But for now, let's crack on. Ergonomics is a science that's all about making sure environments, tools, and tasks are designed and used in ways that fit the worker. Usually when people talk about ergonomics, they're just referring to the physical aspects of tasks. But technically, ergonomics also encompasses making sure the cognitive aspects of tasks match a worker as well. Usually the goal of applying ergonomics is to reduce injury or increase efficiency or consistency in the way a task is performed. It is a super important part of wellness programming in the workplace. Oftentimes when you see the word ergonomic plastered on a product, like an ergonomic keyboard or an ergonomic desk chair, what the manufacturer is conveying is that that product was designed with good body mechanics and anthropometric measurements in mind. Anthropometric measurements are measurements of average body sizes. And by average, most of the time they mean they're considering between the 5th and 95th percentile sized body parts. The problem with that is there is a huge difference between a 5th percentile sized female and a 95th percentile sized male. Take this ergonomic mouse that I have, for example. No matter how well shaped it is, it's going to fit differently in a 5th percentile small hand than it is in a 95th percentile big hand. So don't assume that just because a product has the word ergonomic on the box that you can just slap it in anybody's office and it's gonna fix all their problems. Because not every person is the same. So with that in mind, let's talk about some general workplace recommendations. Starting with computers, since that's such a big part of life these days. In general, you want the shoulders relaxed, elbows near the body, and the forearms close to parallel to the floor with the wrists neutral. Hips, knees, and ankles all at 90 with feet flat on the floor is a good general rule of thumb to go by with seating. Similarly to when you're thinking about wheelchair measurements, having a chair that's really deep or sitting without foot support may cause the chair to dig into the back of the legs and compromise circulation. Whether seated or standing, the keyboard should be at about elbow height. Monitors should be close to at least 20 inches away from the user and aligned so that the neck and torso are close to neutral, so not hunched over and not twisted to the side. This can be tricky with dual monitors, so the best you can do is align yourself with the monitor that you use most and adjust the workstation slightly if you switch to the second monitor for an extended period. If both monitors are used equally, align yourself in the center of both. Laptops are just awful for us, because if your head is in the right place, then your hands aren't, and if your hands are in the right place, then your head's not. In an ideal world, you could get a separate keyboard so that you can align things correctly, but that's not a practical option for everybody, so just do the best you can. As for sitting versus standing and which is better, the answer is both. Sitting all day long has obvious health implications, but standing is more tiring, more stressful on your joints and your back and your circulatory system because it has to fight gravity more. If possible, having the option to alternate between sitting and standing throughout the day is going to be best. You just have to make sure that whenever you switch between the two, your workstation is adjusted so that, again, everything is in good alignment and good position for whatever you're doing. Now that's the case for computer work and other fine motor light activity work where everything is within reasonable reach from where you're sitting. But maybe you have a job with a larger workstation and your materials are spread out over a wider area. If you regularly look like this while you're trying to work while seated, maybe a seated workstation isn't such a great idea for you, and you should stand. The height of your workstation should be determined by the kind of work that you're doing. For fine precision work, you should aim for just above elbow height, so you can see what you're doing and don't have to be holding things floating above your workstation for extended periods of time. For light work, including moving items less than 10 pounds and applying downward forces like wrapping presents or chopping veggies, the station should be just below elbow height. For heavy work that involves items greater than 10 pounds, that workstation should be 4 to 6 inches below elbow height, so you're encouraged to use those big, strong proximal muscles for lifting things, and not your itty-bitty distal muscles. Please remember that, as with anything in the world of OT, these are general recommendations and you need to consider your particular client. For example, say you have a client with cubital tunnel syndrome who fixes watches for a living. I just told you that for fine precision work, like fixing watches, you want the workstation to be just above elbow height. However, a workstation that high is going to encourage sustained elbow flexion. Cubital tunnel syndrome is exacerbated by sustained elbow flexion, so for that individual, you're going to want to recommend a slightly lower workstation. Always, always, always think about the client and not just the task. Let's talk briefly about tools. Handles are super important. They should be pretty comfortable to hold, ideally big enough to be held by your entire hand so as to distribute pressure across a large surface area, and a good tool will minimize the amount of effort and awkward posturing you need to use it. Power tools are great for reducing the amount of effort you need. However, vibration for extended periods of time can be damaging to the body. So if you're going to recommend using a power tool, you may also want to recommend that they wear padded gloves when they use it, or that they use it on low speeds in order to reduce the vibration. A huge part of tool ergonomics is how the client holds the tool. Again, thinking about your client specifically and not just the tool. You generally want to keep the elbow bent and close to the body, and the wrist in a nice neutral position. Like, look at how I'm holding this screwdriver. A lot of people naturally want to get into this position, but my elbow's kicked out way away from my body, and look at how weirdly contorted my wrist is. But if I just flip my hand over like this, it brings my elbow in close to my body, and my wrist is now in a neutral position. Or if I'm screwing something into a vertical surface, again, a lot of people naturally are going to want to come into this position. And the elbow's okay, but look at how much ulnar deviation I have on my wrist. For this, I can change the position of my body in relation to the screwdriver, and now my wrist is in a better, more neutral position. Some tasks aren't going to have perfect positions. You as a clinician are going to have to work with your client to try and collaboratively problem solve some better postures and positions. Of course, you can't talk about posture without talking about lifting. I feel like proper body mechanics for lifting are pretty well known, so I'm not going to dwell on this for very long, but just for a quick recap. When possible, make it so heavy items are stored close to hip height rather than on the floor to make them easier to lift. Store heavy things so that your feet can get close to them to be picked up. No twisting. Lift with your legs and not with your back. Use both sides of your body evenly. And use a moderately wide base of support before picking something up. So now let's talk a little bit about workplace ergonomic evaluations and injury prevention. If you're providing ergonomic evaluations to a company, usually your goal is to reduce that company's losses related to workplace injury. You're going to want to start with looking for risk factors in the workplace. Risk factors include repetitive movements, like someone on an assembly line doing the same thing over and over and over again all day long. Forceful movements, like extensive lifting, gripping, pushing. Awkward postures, either for a long time or repetitively. Think about the body mechanics we just talked about for lifting. Or maybe a plumber who has to crawl around on their knees all the time. Or a secretary who has to look off to their side at their monitor on and off all day. Excessive vibration. We mentioned the use of power tools earlier, but this is also a concern for people who drive for considerable amounts of their job. Extreme temperatures. I remember when I used to work in food service, I hated doing inventory because you'd have to stand in the freezer for extended periods of time. And contact stress, which is pressing a body part against an edge or a surface, like a chef whose knife maybe isn't sharp enough, or someone who types it for a long period of time during the day, resting their arms on the edge of their desk. These are the kinds of things you're going to want to be on the lookout for and trying to prevent. If you're implementing interventions for an entire workforce to try and prevent injury from ever occurring, that is primary prevention. Secondary prevention is the early detection of work-related injury. So that may look like, for example, teaching workers the early signs of back pain so that something can be done about it before it gets worse. Tertiary prevention is treatment of an injury or condition that has already occurred, and you're trying to restore as much function as possible for that individual, as well as minimize their risks for complications later on. Once you've identified the risks in the workplace, you obviously then want to take steps to try to reduce these risks. OSHA categorizes the strategies to achieve this. Depending on what resource you look at, the categories are slightly different, but the categories that I'm gonna go by and share with you today are engineering controls, work practice controls, and administrative controls. Engineering controls focus on the environment and the tasks, not the worker. It's things like making sure that the workstation is set up in a way to reduce awkward posturing, or making sure that the tools that are available are ergonomic. I remember this as engineering equals environment. Work practice controls involve making sure that workers know how to perform their tasks safely. This can include training in proper body mechanics for lifting, like we talked about, what personal protective equipment they're supposed to be wearing, or exercises and stretches that they can do. They're things that you can train the worker in, and then it's up to the worker themselves to remember to carry out those things. I remember this as work practice equals worker performance. Administrative controls are interventions that are trying to reduce exposure to risk factors. Generally, they seem to be things that are implemented by management. It could be things like slowing down a production line, or rotating workers through different stations so that they're not doing the exact same repetitive thing the entire day, or allowing for periodic rest breaks. Unlike the things that fall under work practice controls, a worker generally can't just decide that they're going to work more slowly, or do a different task, or take a break. In a lot of workplaces, you need approval from a supervisor to be able to do those things. So for this, I remember that administrative controls come from authority. So to recap, engineering controls are to do with the environment. Work practice controls are to do with worker performance, and administrative controls come from authority. So at this point in the process, you've assessed the risk factors, you've implemented whatever strategies you think are appropriate, and now it's time to evaluate your outcomes. Again, I want to highlight that usually the goal of these programs is to reduce company losses, not reduce the number of injuries. I know that might sound a little counterintuitive, but if you make it your program's goal just to reduce the number of injuries, you might inadvertently encourage some practices that result in workers just not reporting their injuries at all, and that's definitely not what you want. So, when you're looking at outcomes, instead of just counting the number of injuries that were reported, you're more likely trying to look at if you were able to control the number and severity of injuries in a way that translated into less money lost for the company. And that's a wrap on workplace ergonomics and injury prevention. There is so much out there to learn about occupational therapy's role in the workplace, but I do hope this little video series on work rehab has helped highlight some of the most important topics that an entry-level practitioner should understand, and that it makes learning this content a little more easy. Tertiary. Tertiary.